hold the dagger. Fine looking now, but once covered in blood. But how much blood has this blade really shed? Oceans and seas of blood, inestimable. The Red Dagger. Wat Tyler, John Ball, Joanna Ferrour, the Peasant's Revolt, and the City of London's Weapons of Mass Destruction by Heathcote Williams. A bloodstained dagger is an accurate symbol for the financial power of the City of London, featuring on its flag in heraldic grandeur a shaft designed to skewer and gore. It's derived from the dagger that killed the great rebel hero Wat Tyler, who with his crew challenged London on behalf of the poor. The dagger survives and is on display in Fishmongers Hall, in London's secretive mini-state within a state. Its sinister red silhouette is always there on London's coat of arms, like a trophy, signifying Wat Tyler's slaughter is something to celebrate. But the 100,000 who marched on London in 1381 were serfs, sick and tired of being kept as virtual slaves by the feudal equivalents of corporate power. People were trapped, taxed to death, worked into early graves. 100,000 of those upon whose exploitation the wealth of feudal society depended, from ploughmen to cowmen, milkmaids to spinsters to weavers to sheep shearers, all trapped by a bondage that only death ended. So their spokesman, Wat Tyler, demanded equality. All should be free and of one condition. But instead of sympathy, he aroused suspicion. But Wat Tyler's band was rocking England's power elite to its core through their opposition to the Statute of Labourers. This plague-inspired law kept the people enthralled to the lords whom they viewed as cozeners, plunderers, merchants of royal favours. The statute decreed the maximum wage that masters needed to pay their servants, though those already disdained, abject, reduced by poll taxes levied on man, woman and child, a vampiric oligarchist, insidious system of systematic abuse. Therefore, labourers were forbidden to withdraw their labour or to even mutually discuss their conditions. To combine to make demands upon the lord was illegal, and if you escaped a feudal tyrant, you faced prison. In the poem Piers Plowman, the poet William Langland depicted life for manual labourers who were landless. They cursed the king and the king's justices for making laws to grieve labourers. Their miseries were endless. So, on May 30th, 1381, the insurrection was kindled at Brentwood. Essex villagers had made minimal poll tax demands, so poll tax commissioners, backed by royal troops, were dispatched to inquire into the subject's impudent lack of concern. The result was surprising, with both the tax collectors and troops ejected from half a dozen villages as hundreds of poll tax defaulters banded together to fight what they regarded as state-sanctioned pillage. For England's villagers were sick and tired of working from dawn till dusk for the benefit of the king and the lord of the manor, forbidden to move or to marry or buy or sell or even grind their own corn without fines and fees and permission from their oppressors. Medieval landlords would calculate the minimum diet, the least amount of beans, gruel and oats, the minimum calorific requirement to keep a peasant productive, and the landlords would cynically compare notes. Reactionary cabals of landowning courtiers are those they depended on living in grime, and any thought of improving the lives of the peasants were viewed as disruptive, if not a crime. So the people, no one impressed by the poll tax commissioner's status, would seize them. One was Sir Robert Belknap, the Chief Justice of the Court of Common Pleas. He was forced to swear on the Bible that he'd take part in no further oppression, but then, and then, disdainfully released. But the poll tax commissioners persisted in their bullying, and although those under 16 were supposedly excused, offensive body searches were conducted for signs of pubic hair, which meant that the despised tax was imposed after the young had been sexually abused. The tax collector was truly fobbed off by the inhabitants of the village of Fobbing. The inhabitants of Fobbing would only pay him with their arrows instead of their coins for his racketeering royal taxes. The revolt spread quickly, with more tax collectors attacked, and then erupted in Kent, where Maidstone Castle was torched. With Wat Tyler elected leader, the rebels took Rochester Castle before turning to the power base of a landowning church. The church was the greatest economic power in England. It owned a third of the land, forests and mines, fisheries, rights of pasture, and it charged cruel rents. John Ball accused it of economic crimes. As Wat Tyler saw that the gathering host of several thousand was there, but the rising was still lacking John Ball, so they stormed Maidstone Jail to release that radical cleric who'd been preaching a radical revolution for all. John Ball criticised the church when the abbot of Burton brutally told his serfs that they owned nothing but their bellies. John Ball responded, "We are formed in Christ's likeness, yet they treat us like beasts, berating such ecclesiastical Machiavellis." In the beginning, all were created equal. The servitude of man to man was introduced by the unjust dealings of the wicked and is contrary to God's will. Thus John Ball described how natural justice had been introduced. For if God had intended some to be serfs and others lords, he would have made a distinction at the beginning. Now, like a good husbandman tending his crops and uprooting the weeds that destroy the grain, you should destroy the lords of this kingdom. He prescribed the same medicine for lawyers and judges. When the great ones have been cut off, John Ball glowered, all shall enjoy equal freedom. All shall have the same nobility, rank and power. John Ball had no parish, but preached in churchyards and by hedgerows, denouncing the dragon of exploitation. He railed against the bishops and abbots' luxurious living and envisaged an entirely new nation, a new England freed from prisons and torture chambers and the executioner's gibbet and block, a new Jerusalem governed by Christ's beatitudes, a land where the poor weren't constantly placed in the dock. He was to preach his message for 25 years about how conditions in England might be bettered. Despite being frequently jailed and then excommunicated, to the common folk, he was the people's shepherd. And as John Ball's dream of universal equality was feared, at the first sign of the Essex Rising, he was arrested. "Soon I shall be released by 20,000 amen," he prophesied, and Wat Tyler and company arrived soon after, just as requested. Then Wat Tyler and John Ball burst into England's great cathedral and told Simon Sudbury, the Archbishop of Canterbury, "We're here to depose you. We can speak with God like directly. We don't need you as our pampered intermediary." John Ball sent messages in rhyme couplets to village after village, each urging insurrection. "John Ball, I greeteth you all. Understand, he hath rung your bell. Come with might and right and deliver yourselves from your hell." John Ball asked them to cast off the fetters that tied them to the land and to the lords who were the earth's traitors. For if the land belonged to anybody, it was simply the collective property of all its cultivators. John Ball addressed himself to John Nameless, Piers Plowman, John Truman, meaning honest folk with some strength of mind. He invited them to join him to chastise Hod the Robber, by which he meant state officials and their kind. Stand manlike together in truth, Ball said, and help truth, and truth shall help you. He urged audacity, since in his words, England's government held every vice to be a virtue. And protesters were arrested, or as John Ball put it, truth hath been set under lock, and corrupt sheep fill the church, and falseness reigneth in every flock. The Black Death had reduced the population by almost a half, and therefore labour was at a premium. The Lord's answer, more back-breaking work to make up for low levels of production in this society suffering from moral delirium. And if labourers bridled at their ruthless treatment, they would be summoned by government scriveners, imprisoned, arrested either for breaking the statute or evading the tax. Either way, they ended as political prisoners. And those who had the temerity to ask for the same wage paid before the plague's depopulation of England would be marked on the forehead with the letter F for falsity. It was burned deep into the flesh with a brand. On June 10th, Joan Hancock and Agnes Jekin spoke up for the lives that the Lords were trying to take, only to be fettered and manacled in Canterbury Jail until Tyler and Ball staged a jailbreak. On June 14th, a Cambridge woman named Marjorie Starr denounced the poll tax demands as the devil's works. She seized them and burnt them and tossed the ashes to the wind, crying, away with the learning of clerks, because the learning of clerks had them signed, sealed and delivered, and they'd look askance at their hard-won means of subsistence being seized by the armed agents of a remote king to fight pointless dynastic wars in France. So when the rebels invaded the houses of the great landowners, the first place they went for was the muniment room, which held the deeds and the documents relating to their serfdom. Thus paper and parchment first fell victim to the rebels' new broom. The rebel host swelled, surged over London Bridge and stormed the Tower of London, releasing prisoners from dungeons and chains. They found the King's treasurer, Sir Robert Hales, clutching his coffers, so they relieved him of his ill-gotten gains. The first poll tax had been imposed by the King's uncle, John of Gaunt, to pay for the Hundred Years' War with the poor's pennies and pounds. Though the tax would benefit Gaunt himself massively, it was worth 110 billion in today's money. So the rebels burnt his Savoy Palace to the ground. He built it with the proceeds of the plunder he carried out at Poitiers and at Crecy. He'd spent £35,000 on it, then the equivalent of a third of the wages bill of the entire English army. The records of the Court of King's Bench show that this raid was led by a woman, Joanna Ferrour, named chief perpetrator and leader, riding around on horseback in improvised armour. Surprisingly, Gaunt was away, but his stuffed jerkin served as a target to be filled with arrows by Joanna and the rebel crowd. Then Joanna found a treasure chest full of gold coins. A sovereign per person, sovereign equality, cried out loud. Barrels of gunpowder that Gaunt kept there were ignited, and London's most lavish building was left in ruins amid popular clamour. Burning for a week, Joanna's smouldering ruins indicated the transience of a rich man's power, influence and glamour. After Newgate Jail was stormed, the Fleet Prison's governor was pricked with a sabre, along with the Lord Chancellor and the Inns of Court lawyers whose privileges rested on taxes and forced labour. Bundles of documents that legitimated the serfs' shackles by couching them in Latin legalese were seized and liberated from lawyers scuttling like rats around their temple chambers. They were hurled onto bonfires and incinerated. The Lord Chief Justice, Sir John Cavendish, tried to escape by boat, but he was spotted by three women, Catherine Gaiman, Margaret Wright and Margaret Drinkinere, who dispensed their own rough justice when they caught him. The King's Bench prison was sprung, and its keeper, Richard Inworth, a being known as the Tormentor without pity, fled to Westminster Abbey for sanctuary, but the magic didn't work. He was dragged out and lost his head on the streets of the city. Lambeth Palace was targeted, and then the Marshalsea prison, which held yet more victims of the draconian statute. Those within were released to join the rebel army in its defeat, in its aim to defeat all those persecuting the destitute. From a turret in the tower, the king could see the rebel army and hear the gale force murmurings of the multitude. The flames and plumes of smoke that punctuated every horizon gave an indication of the commons' hostile attitude. Panicked, the Earl of Salisbury told the royal council, "If the rebels are successful, it will be all over with us and our heirs, and England shall be a desert." Meaning, presumably, that only members of his class could possibly live in clover. The next day, June the 14th, the king met the rebels at Mile End and was persuaded to accede to the people's demands that feudal service be abolished, along with market monopolies, and the bishops would lose their power and land. William of Usk, a chronicler of the time, recorded that Wat Tyler demanded the liberation of all prisoners, for he viewed poll tax commissioners who locked up the poor for debt were nothing more than extortionate swindlers. "No man shall serve another man," Wat Tyler said, "but by his own free will." The rebels now called themselves the True Commons and had formed a revolutionary council, which, through open-air debate, worked out their demands and by shows of hands settled on a charter to show the royalist mafia ranged against them precisely what it was they were after. John Ball explained his socio-economic theory plainly enough for anyone to understand. "The Lords claim to be more Lords than we are rests on their power to force us to labour so that they may spend. The Lords have good food, fine wine, elegant clothes," John Ball explains, "thanks to the surplus they extracted from their serfs. They then protect their thievery by law and by force, and make themselves feel like giants and the rest like dwarves." The king met the rebels again the next day at Smithfield, now afraid that his old kingdom would be demolished. For now, Wat Tyler demanded that all be treated equally, and every aristocratic title be abolished. Smithfield in those days was a large open space lying between the Holborn River and Faggles Well Brook. St. Bart's Hospital and the Charterhouse, its other borders, held a truculent crowd with a purposeful look. Wat Tyler wore a thick woolen hood on his head that day, which he kept on rather than showing any deference. Wat Tyler gave no sign that he was overawed by the king, nor by the crown, the elite's preferred point of reference. The writer John Gower noted that Wat Tyler had a nickname. The rebel crowd called him the Jackdaw. So the Jackdaw stirred up all the others with his outrageous shouts, and he turned the people's minds towards war. Wat Tyler was supported by John Ball at his side in his monkish garb, who personally warned the king that matters shall not go well in England until all shall be in common. The king's advisers saw their system being torn into tatters, particularly when the crowd took up John Ball's chant. "When Adam delved and Eve span, who was then the gentleman? When Adam delved and Eve span, who was then the gentleman? When Adam delved and Eve span, who was then the gentleman?" They were being swayed by the priests urging rants. "There are those in England who are treated as beasts, while others idle in velvet, but by whose leave? Why are they so much more lords than we are of ourselves? Are we not descended from the same parents, Adam and Eve? So much the worse shall it be for the lords of this realm, Wat Tyler added, if this charter be refused. He now envisaged an England of self-governing communes, a land where no one in town or country would be ill-used. No man shall exercise lordship over another man, and as we are oppressed by so vast a horde of clerks and bishops, the property of Holy Church should be taken and distributed for the common good. And furthermore, if serfdom persisted, then those who benefited from the callous feudal system would be attacked. And furthermore, none shall be compelled to work. Work shall be a collectively agreed social contract. How ill they behave towards us, and for what reason? John Ball asked. For what reasons do they hold us in bondage? But at this moment, the Lord Mayor of London, William Walworth, an influential member of the King's entourage, stepped forward to advise the King, and William Walworth saw no reason why any concessions should be made, for Walworth was benefiting from high-interest loans to the Crown for war, blood money on which the City of London's financial foundations were laid. For Walworth and his tax-farming cronies would blackmail the governments of the day. Do what we want, or we sit on tax money and war loans, the army will mutiny and you'll go bankrupt. There were complaints in Parliament about this gang of plutocrats. But Walworth, now war treasurer, and his friends conspired to keep food prices high and had the King issue the edicts that gave them the monopolies and huge profits they desired. Thus was scarcity produced to the through deceit and calumny, to the advantage of gilded parasites and the oppression of the commonality. But Wat Tyler's idea of fair shares for all was alien to William Walworth, blasphemy to this city courtier, brothel keeper, money grubber, who, when he saw this shoeless ruffian shaking hands with the King, on cue leapt at Wat Tyler with his dagger. Like a coward, William Walworth attacked Wat Tyler from behind, stabbing him in the neck with the infamous blade, setting the standard for generations of city robber barons, self-serving cutthroats who work in the shade. Betrayed, the participants of the Great Rising returned home, only for the King to renege on his every concession, dispatching troops to round up 500 farm labourers who were hanged together on a mass gallows as a lesson. When Wat Tyler and the King had first met at Smithfield, the King said, "All that you ask for, I promise most readily. Now let the people return home, for their requests have been granted." But they'd soon find out all about royal treachery. When they'd first met, it had first been one-to-one. But then guards and courtiers had gathered all around, so the crowd couldn't see what was happening. They couldn't see Wat Tyler dragged to the ground. Then, out of fear, the King would deceive them. "Tyler has been knighted. Your requests have been granted. Now return home." But William Walworth was having Wat Tyler's body beheaded. The King then issued all orders to Walworth. "To protect the city, you are to punish all those who riot against our peace, either by law or by beheading and the mutilation of limbs, whichever seems most expeditious and sensible." Thus was the Sun of Liberty quickly eclipsed. Then the King announced that all the charters for the remission of servitude that he previously signed, he'd now cancelled. The elite's vision of utopia was the King on his throne surrounded by his vassals, while the rest of the population cravenly grovelled. On a tour of Essex, the King sneered at his now forlorn subjects, though as a Christian prince, he was supposedly their brother. "Rustics you were, and rustics you are still. You will remain in bondage, not as before, but incomparably tougher." One rebel leader named Grincup said from the gallows, "Hold firm while you can, and have no thought of me or what I may suffer. For if I die in the cause of liberty, I'll be happy to end my life as a martyr." On hearing this, the cruel king gave orders that Grincup's body was to be strung up, in the king's words, for as long as he could last. When the defiant townspeople took him down and buried him, the malignant monarch had Grincup's corpse returned to the noose just as fast. Commissions of Oyer and Terminer, hear and determine, sentenced both men and women to swing. One, Nicola Carter, was charged with riding armed through the countryside, inciting the commoners to rise against the king. When John Ball was arrested, he refused to plead for mercy, saying simply, "I have done no wrong." He was hanged, drawn and quartered on July 15, but the anarchist priest still lives on in song. On completing his cruel commission, William Walworth was knighted and later buried in St. Michael's Church in the aptly named Crooked Lane. The city later put up a statue to its sadistic role model at Holborn Viaduct. This bastard who'd used money's power to cause pain. William Walworth's successors are as self-serving as Wat Tyler's murderer. For the modern city makes fortunes by investing in arms and getting psyched up by the outrageous profits from speculative deals without ever considering the multitude whom it harms. The city is the monstrous parent of cold-hearted Wall Street, that other imperialist haven for hedge fund traders. The city ensures that economics is both morality and empathy free, as shown by its lavish rewards for dodgy bankers and corporate raiders. The city's money moguls finance political parties through bribery, gaining access to party leaders if they fill party treasuries. So it becomes the politician's priority to please the financiers first. Such rampant corruption's been around for more than six centuries. And as the city gambles on the price of commodities and 60,000 die daily from starvation, it's as if the dagger that killed Wat Tyler, the People's Tribune, is still skewering human aspiration. Oh, but the city's the goose that lays the golden eggs. Its apologists ring-fence it with superstitions. If you disturb it, it'll just fly away and take much-needed capital to enrich our competitor nations. Behold how fragile, vulnerable, diaphanous the city pretends itself, and is pretending to us. Don't criticise, don't insist on accountability and moral responsibility, because it may collapse and fall into crisis again. Do you not understand how important it is? If it's obstructed in the operation of its golden egg factory farm, we will all surely die. Life will grind to a halt. The sun and the moon will no longer rise in the sky. These usurpers, charlatans and mountebanks would have us believe that the whole cosmos depends upon them. A pathetic mirage indeed. They forget that the golden goose's eggs give off toxic fumes, and that it fouls its own nest in its murkiest of lairs, where it's geared to privatising public assets and hiding the profits. The golden goose turns what's ours into theirs. It serves to conduct its unaccountable business deals in its elegant privatised Georgian squares, where, thanks to deregulation initiated by Thatcher, criminal fraud is called dealing in shares. City and Wall Street Investment Bank, JP Morgan, hired Buckingham Palace for a dinner hosted by the arms-dealing pervert Duke of York, attended by the bank's clients, ghoulish gophers like Tony Blair, for pork-barrel politics with gilded knives and crested forks. The city banks love to devise cunning financial instruments of torture, hedging products such as those they called snaps, whereby sexy loans were offered with unnoticed insurance clauses, which ensured that victims went bankrupt and lives collapsed. The city's legions of coke-sniffing hedonists in their pinstripe suits, mole shirts and Ferraris are protected by the politicians and the police force, all of whom believe their city bosses are beyond any inquiries. The square mile of thieves really is a drugs den, for according to Sigmund Freud, wealth is a drug of which addicts need ever-increasing doses to function in their dysfunctional void. And as being enslaved by such a drug widens the empathy gap, the well-heeled and minted don't have to imagine in what fashion the other half live, because they can believe that their status allows them to overlook common decency and human compassion. One Victorian reformer would compare the city to a prehistoric monster who in a mysterious way had survived into the modern world. Freedom for money, the Victorian dragon would shout, and it makes the same ugly cry today. Given deregulation, Wall Street would use the city to commit frauds that in the US would have led to criminal conviction. Bundles of worthless subprime mortgages sold through London, leading to stock market crash and mass eviction. The city banks really do love to concoct fraudulent financial products, such as repackaging debt as an asset, selling air, first to provide leverage, then to boost confidence, while all the time there was absolutely nothing really there. Roll up! Roll up! Welcome to the zombie desert of the commodification of all phenomena, the reduction of all life to saleable things, and the thing of things, money! Roll up, roll up! Welcome to the wheel of fortune, the circulation of pointlessness, the carousel of vacuity. Welcome to the city of death. The city's there to lubricate human nature at its nastiest. Take Lord Rothermere, the proprietor of the Daily Mail. The city helps him hide his millions in Bermuda tax havens, being the profits of his paper that has xenophobia for sale. A supporter of Hitler was once made a hereditary peer, which enabled him to join the group of British legislators. Hurrah for the black shirts, cried the first Lord Rothermere, and his family still are professional race haters. An ex-employee described Rothermere's paper perfectly. The ideal Daily Mail story leaves the reader hating someone or something, for it demonises the weak so that others can feel themselves superior. The city's dagger has come to represent a financial fascism whose message is that justice is trumped by money and force. The sinister sign all over London Square Mile sums up this sham democracy. Merely money's Trojan horse. I'll break there for 5 minutes at the end of the first part of the Red Dagger. Come back in five minutes, or I'll stick the dagger in some more.
Do
you remember all the lines?
Oh, yeah.
Listen, I know
one
person did it.
Okay.
Are we ready?
Here we go. The Red Dagger. Wat Tyler, John Ball, Joanna Ferrour, and the weapon, the Peasant's Revolt, and the weapons, and the City of London's weapons of mass destruction. Part two. The city's history is of greedy men cornering the market, making their fortunes by making commodities of food, land and blood, then being given a title to give themselves airs and graces so that them and their families feel good. The city father of the current Prime Minister made at least 30 million, a fortune he passed on to his deceitful Tory scum, son.
Create yourself there.
Cameron Senior set up tax havens in Geneva and Panama, thus meriting the perennial jibe, Tory scum! Ian Cameron was the senior director in Blairmore Holdings, which took advantage of capital controls being lax. The PM's father's company sought sophisticated investors, in other words, the filthy rich who resent paying tax. As ever, the city finance capital funds the Tory party to ensure that it dances to its monstrous mother's tune. Don't prosecute warmongers, there's money in bombs. Spare all those born with a silver spoon. In the city, there's no industry, just coffee chains. Like Java's upas tree, nothing grows in the city's shade. Its dark towers are for devotees of Shakespeare's saint-seducing gold. It stands for humanity's shadow side where nothing's ever made. Tell not how Java's upas tree spreads poison far and near. Of all the poison trees on earth, the deadliest is here. Fixed firmly in the British soil, though old yet undecayed, its baneful vapours stunt the growth of all within its shade. Oh heaven, may thy lightning strike and cleave it to its roots. Then folks shall plant fair freedom's tree and all partake its fruits. But in these towers, the city, lurk the gnomes of Mammon and Moloch's high priests. Looking down on the world, they happily milk, turning London into the global centre of money laundering, serving rich clients with perfect teeth and smiles of silk. Crooked officials who loot their countries know they've access to shell companies in a global financial centre, falling over itself to secure their wealth, sell them billion-pound palaces and be their money mentors. According to watchdog Transparency International, the global capital of dirty money is London. They even have a Corruption Perceptions Index ranking the city as the fruit of corruption's number one home. The city's slick number crunchers are housed in these forbidding towers, each one built to an inhuman scale. The city's triumphant emblems of economic inequality, boasting architecturally, we're too big to fail. So it's not surprising when the victims of money's violations sometimes rise to give their oppressors a jolt. For billionaire vampires who steal others' lives are an affront and should naturally stir memories of the peasants' revolt. We are zealots for truth and justice, Wat Tyler claimed. Not thieves and robbers, and he was right, though to chant, a rebel, while ransacking Lambeth Palace was viewed with popular delight. A rebel, a revolution! And though Wat Tyler and his friends were viewed with disdain by an elite suffering from moral corrosion, similar attacks today on migrants, benefit claimants, and the undeserving poor invite a similar social explosion. For the Sunday Times Rich List revealed that in the depths of a depression, the 1,000 richest individuals in this country were worth more than $450 billion, not counting the even greater sum salted away in tax havens thanks to the city, all reinvested to make more money, to buy more privilege for their children and their children alone, giving the lie to the social mobility illusion and to ensure that all the old divisions are thereby set in stone. Hell's a city much like London, Shelley said, and to Cobbett it was the great Wen, a cancerous cyst that sucked at England's lifeblood, a selfish merchant oligarch's gambling den. Hell's a city much like London, a populous and smoky city. There are all sorts of people undone, on little or no fund done, small justice and still less pity. There's a castle, and a cannon, a cobbit, and a castle ray. All sorts of caitiff corpses planning. All sorts of cozening for trepanning. Corpses less corrupt than they. There's a shit who has lost his wits, or sold them, none knows which, and wanders forth a double ghost, and though as thin as fraud almost, ever grows more grim and rich. There's a chancery court, a king, a manufacturing mob, a set of thieves who themselves are sent, similar thieves to represent an army and a public debt, which last is a scheme of paper money means being interpreted. Bees, keep your wax, give us the honey, and we will plant while skies are sunny, flowers which in winter serve instead. And there's great talk of revolution and great chance of despotism. Soldiers, camps, confusion, tumults, lotteries, rage, delusion, gin, suicide and methodism. And there are taxes on wine and bread and meat and beer and tea and cheese from which these patriots pure are fed, who gorge themselves before they reel to bed. The tenfold essence of all these lawyers, judges, old obnubbers are there, bailiffs, chancellors, bishops, great and little robbers, rhymesters, pamphleteers, stock jobbers, men of glory from the wars, thrusting, toiling, wailing, moiling, frowning, preaching, such a riot, each with never ceasing labour, while he thinks he cheats his neighbour, cheats his own heart of quiet. And all of these meet at levees, dinners, convivial, political, suppers for epic poets, seas, where small talk dies in agonies, breakfast professional and critical, snacks and lunches so aldermanic that one would furnish for 10 dinners, where reigns a Cretan tongue panic, lest news rust, Dutch or Alamanic, should make some losers and some winners. At conversazione, balls, conventicles and drawing rooms, courts of law, committees, calls, other morning clubs, bookstalls, churches, masquerades and tombs. And this is hell. And in this mother, all are damnable and damned. Each one damning damns the other. They are damned by one another. By none other are they damned. The city cannot hide that its nest egg derives from serfdom, from indentured servitude, from slavery. As the first capitalist power, the city spearheaded colonial expansion, for which no profitable activity was too unsavoury. And without child labour, the Industrial Revolution wouldn't have been such a big deal. And children in mines and in mills would profit the founder of the modern Conservative Party, Sir Robert Peel. The city's heritage comes from the intertwined of class, power and gold, and the low-minded interconnection of war, gain and fame. And as if to normalise this state of affairs, the city's voice, the mainstream media, proclaim news of celebrity and war and economy again and again and again. The city corporation's assets are never revealed, but it's rumoured to own caverns full of gold bars, and the land and securities on which loans were once raised yield millions in interest to empower city czars. The so-called city cash fund spends millions every year on lobbying and ensuring that the state is subservient so the well-heeled can come and go as they please and all financial regulation is compliant. Thus, corporation tax is reduced and tax breaks worth 500 million to city capitalists are fixed up at swanky dues for power brokers at the Mansion House. It's called banquet lobbying by the city lobbyists. The city even has an unelected official that sits in Parliament with the unsettling title of the Remembrancer. The Remembrancer, he and his seven lawyers, vets all legislation to ensure it's city-friendly, and quite undemocratically, the city's gopher has a seat in the chamber. But the Remembrancer forgets that the weight he throws around on the city's behalf derives from the darker deeds of the British Empire, namely an outright worship of the golden calf, because the charter companies founded in the city would finance the North American slave trade. The city would seize Africa, America, India like a robber looking for gold and for people to degrade. Why should we not form a secret society with but one intention, said Cecil Rhodes, the Empire's tool. The furtherance of the British Empire and the bringing of the whole world under British rule. Africa's lying waiting before us. We should take her, Rhodes sighed. And starting with the Royal African Company, every city company has obliged. City iron merchant and speculator Ambrose Crowley manufactured irons and manacles for the tethering of slaves on ships. Finance was provided by John Angerstein, founder of Lloyd's of London, on the back of his Grenadian slave estates. But ever sensitive about its reputation, the city takes $10 million a year from taxpayers to mishandle. It's called the City Offset, and it's used on damage limitation and covering up all the city's outrageous financial scandals, such as the Lehman Brothers collapse, or Bernie Madoff's pyramid scheme, a notorious $50 billion racket, or AIG's failed derivatives operation, or Barclays LIBOR disaster. Clever PR ensures that the city's never held up by any such adverse traffic. And so, the snorts of cocaine and the spoons of caviar can continue in mergers and acquisitions to oil the cogs of pathological money machines as the world's precious resources are swallowed up by sweaty fingers jabbing at city computer screens. And in the shadow dance of the deficit, the biggest, longest running con in history, generations are sentenced to debt slavery, no different from the Middle Ages really, where the serfs were cheated of their birthright by conniving baronial knavery. And thanks to speculative house buying driven by city greed, London becomes affordable only to the mega rich, with the poor as an invisible service industry, or simply homeless, left there to be stepped over, left to starve in a ditch. As I wandered through his chartered street, down near where the chartered Thames does flow, I mark in every face I meet, marks of weakness, marks of woe, in every cry of every man, in every infant's cry of fear, in every voice, in every band, the mind-forged manacles I hear. How the chimney sweepers cry, every blackening church appalled. How the hapless soldier sigh, runs like blood down palace walls. Most through midnight streets I hear, how the youthful harlot's curse blasts the newborn infant's tear, and blights with plagues the marriage hearse. The city, Tolstoy's old saying, that behind every great fortune lies a great crime, ought to give every multimillionaire an antisocial stigma. Why is being one different from being a rapist, or a paedophile, or at least a drunk driver, in the same category as the odious Gordon Gecko, or even Goldfinger? And as the squeezed majority watch the criminal wealth gap grow, when the lion's share goes to those who don't need it, the rest are inclined to shout, fuck it, no! Because there's now the greatest division in human history between the leisurely rich and the troubled poor. And with the city stashing away trillions, there's a burning temptation to smash down that door. The city corporation invests in arms, in every arms company it can find. From Lockheed Martin to Boeing to Northrop Grumman to Halliburton, their investments increases, they decimate mankind. From Raytheon to BAE Systems to General Dynamics, the city makes a speciality of this sickly field. They have no concern for bloodletting and body counts, their only concern being financial yield. And to protect them, then UK Prime Minister Tony Blair ordered the Serious Fraud Office not to reveal the £1 billion paid in kickbacks by BAA Systems to Saudi royals in the £48 billion Al Yaman's deal. And while the rest of the world is uplifted by the Arab Spring, the current Prime Minister and his friends, a gang of slimy city arms traders, go on opportunistic junket to the Middle East in turmoil. Aim being, sell killing machines to oil-rich dictators. Mass murder is the arms industry's unspoken ingredient. It represents that business's iron profit stream. What a contrast to William Morris's vision of utopia in his book about John Ball's dream. In it, John Ball returned to address those in the present. Merry were the days on earth, John Ball said, where fellowship was heaven and hell was every man for himself. But during the Rising, Essex was aflame, and Surrey, and Kent, Hendon, and Chiswick, and Mitcham, and Kingston, and Henley sent contingents to swell the peasant army and cause England's rulers alarm. Then the revolt spread north and became national, and lord after lord were forced to sign charters releasing the serfs, and they knew if they refused, they'd be put to the sword. The court chronicler, Froissart, noted in a time-serving way, observe how well matters turned out. For had the rebels been successful in their intentions, the whole nobility of England would have been destroyed in a rout. But the rebels made striking inroads. No poll tax for 700 years, and the Rising gave the lie to usurper feudalism, just as the current city's exposure as a terrorist bankster state highlights the need to decapitate consumer capitalism. But even so, a new king mob arises, a new writer of wrongs, named Anonymous, arising with cybernetic stealth, hopefully able to hack into all those corporate bank balances, hopefully able to redistribute all that ill-gotten wealth. But during the revolt, the rebel crowd would chant, scepter and crown, they shall tumble down. And as every action has an equal and opposite reaction, Carmen guarantees that greed isn't set in stone, but the prostitute city that distorts others' lives has an appetite for prostitutes and escorts, however trafficked. What a contrast to Wat Tyler and John Ball, who burnt down Walsh brothels so the city sex pimp's income from sex slaves was thwarted. One historian commented on the rebels burning the brothels as they approached London Bridge to cross the Thames. When Mayor Walworth saw such a lucrative source of income destroyed, his wrath must have risen higher than the flames. And in Fagin's account, 9 days that shook England, he noted, the brothel burning turned Walworth into an even more implacable enemy of the revolution. But to the rebels, he was simply the worst man on earth. He'd feathered his nest by turning women into chattels whom he locked up in cages with beds in the squalid skews of Bankside, and he paid them for the privilege with a pox. The transaction between a client and a prostitute reveals the true hidden nature of money. We're all assured of the shame and degradation of the sex worker, but what of the shame and degradation of the client? What shape does that take? Where does that go? It's submerged into the banknotes and transferred back to the proletarian, who must then bear a double burden. Banknotes are magic talismans, alchemical blotters that soak up the shame and mask the faces of thieving malefactors. Shameful, shameless charlatans who turn people, including themselves, into things. Banknotes are the operators of the thingification process, the actors in the theatre of death and the necrotic, meretricious money, the mortician of creation. The grim ferryman, Ciaran, must have his money to take you across the Styx to Hades. But what if you have none? Are you condemned to live? Money claims to be the power to live, or even the possibility of transportation to heaven. But as we all know, it's the entrance ticket to hell. Undeterred, their city puts up a statue to this knife-wielding brothel keeper to keep company with its colonial merchants and their military. Though were it to put up statues to Wat Tyler and John Ball, it might make a start on transforming its morality. For just as there's a wall of the communards in Paris's Père Lachaise Cemetery, room could be found on the route of Wat Tyler's march for the memory of a deceived peasantry. But as if to hide its low intentions in plain sight, the city guards its borders with devouring dragons north, south, east and west. Forgetting that in popular fable, it's those who kill life-threatening beasts and who make the powerful powerless that are praised as the people's best. Tom Paine, writing in The Rights of Man in 1791, described Wat Tyler as a disinterested and intrepid man. Therefore, the Norfolk father of the US Constitution described himself as a fan. Paine wrote, "The demands put by Wat Tyler before King Richard were on a more just and public ground than those put by the barons before King John, a king who was notoriously unsound." And Paine added that if the barons merited a monument to be erected at Runnymede, Wat Tyler should have one at Smithfield. But sadly, as yet, no one's found the need. But Wat Tyler's firebrand speeches and John Ball's utopian visions inspired the leveller and digger and chartist revolution, which Marx and Engels explained were about overthrowing the entire English constitution. And although his head ended up on a pole on London Bridge, Wat Tyler's tongue can still cut across the centuries, inspiring captive spirits with his demand for the opening of all the penitentiaries. Wat Tyler galvanised the people and gave his life to free the serfs and to give two fingers to the Norman yoke. And he can still upset reactionary historians and Tories glorified in a world reduced to a financial joke. Robert Southey wrote, "He was one gifted with great energy of mind, quick to perceive the right and swift to act when justice required, his zeal unconfined. But a financial fundamentalism persists that insists that money measure every last scrap of the life force, even as it shortens and destroys people's lives and long, long ago should have been stifled directly at source." Clement Attlee once lamented that, "Time and again we have seen in this country that there is another power than that which has its seat at Westminster," by which he meant the city dragon, looking for things and people to devour. For were the principle, whatever makes money is good, is hell, then nothing whatever could be bad. Even if the city's investments risk humanity's total destruction, so what if the interest makes some bankers feel glad? And the city's chillingly named Geiger Counter Investment Trust buys and sells uranium. Forget about Chernobyl and Fukushima. When money's at stake, humanity's secondary. It's even alien. Another company the city dragon protects bankrolls those dealing in Malaysian wood, those who vandalise rainforests to plant palm oil, the main ingredient in processed food. Thus, heart disease is accelerated, and humanity's engaging cousin, the orangutan, is driven from its habitat to make way for cooking fat. Ancient lands are slashed and burned, and even breathable air's under attack. The bank in question, HSBC, housed in the city, in its forest of concrete pinnacles, its moneymakers stuffed into one of these malignant towers, which unlike green trees that soar, just simply lower. Inside them, the dagger that killed Wat Tyler is still wielded, but this time it's by finance's cold dead hand. With its stocks and its shares and its dividends and its bonds, it's plunged repeatedly into the earth's green and pleasant land. The smartest investors are still betting on fossil fuels, insists a lout in a city wine bar. His gold credit card backed up by seabirds in oil slick and babies breathing the exhaust fumes from his car. The ancient Babylonians called gold the shit of hell, and the city's full of its embodiments, the living shits who raise the cost of living, seek a vacuous status through brand names, smart addresses and designer glitz, who struttingly say, I'm far too rich and far too important to play a full part in the community. I've no wish to share my wealth, thank you very much, and I'm an accountant to assure my superiority. The city's exemplified by the likes of Steve Wynn, casino billionaire. Guys like me are job creators. We don't like bullseyes being painted on our backs. But the contrast between the 24 million going hungry per day and Wynn's annual income of 4 billion is a provocative fact, which makes one think that capitalism is a license to kill by stealth through financial stress, leading to illness and suicide, while the peace of mind of all those with wealth must be undisturbed and the rule of money preside. Thus, much of this makes black, white, makes foul, fair, wrong, right, old, base, noble, old, young, coward, valiant. This yellow slave makes the whore leprosy adored. This it is that makes the wapened widow wed again. She whom the spittlehouse and ulcerous sores would pass the gorge at. This spices and embalms to April day. Thou visible god that solders close impossibilities and makes them kiss. A multimillionaire prime minister sits on a golden chair and accepts the city's brazen hospitality, gorging himself on game with their gilded cutlery, before Dodgy Dave stands up to accept the microphone to lecture the world on the necessity of permanent austerity. And as his neo-feudal city guards its synthetic wealth and its company cars and its private schools and its frauds and its Learjets and its diamonds and its expensive junk, a society that worships money as its anti-social god. Upton Sinclair once said that fascism is capitalism plus violence. And facelift after facelift from democracy's charade cannot change the nature of this cruel and savage beast whose conscience is permanently mislaid. Behold a city of brass, guarded by two dragons and one knife. The crystallization of all the wealth, power and brutality that went before. It claims that its glittering activity is the motor of all life. Well, in truth, it is death to its core. Its senseless expansion first produces, then exterminates the poor. Again, we must say, is it not time to smash down this door? We live in their world, an infinity of human degradation. True life for itself must negate this negation and drop all this delusional bullshit that we all live in one nation. But during the peasants' revolt, the despondent lifted their heads and began devaluing authorities' currency. By stopping believing in the power of their oppressors with right on their side, they kick-started history. And nearly 700 years later, on November the 5th, outside Parliament, banners are unfurled, defiance displayed, each banner highlighting the same stubborn divisions and adding, be afraid, be very afraid. Got money for war, but can't feed the poor. The corrupt fear us, the honest support us, the heroic join us. How many thousands have died because of the cuts? One bar reads, parasites MPs give themselves free electricity and then make pensioners freeze to death. The crowd moves off down the mall, chanting, off with their heads, with each fiery breath. Then the palace, that symbol of inequality with its 600 rooms, is attacked. Palace flunkies twitch at curtains, nervous seeing their police force push back. Then the hard-faced building is hit by Guy Fawkes Night rockets, and as each one scores a bullseye, the crowds cheer. A woman shouts up through the gates, "We're poor!" The crowd echoes her with more menace, "We're poor and we're here! Whose palace? Our palace!" They chant up through gilded railings, "And why are you, parasite, so rich?" Then suddenly, Wat Tyler's in London comes back to life, thanks to a 700-year-old itch. The University of Berkeley in California conducted a series of experiments which showed that those who drove very expensive cars were less likely to stop for pedestrians. When test subjects were left with jars of sweets, and when rich subjects were told they'd been reserved for children, it was found that there was no end to their arrogance. For the rich subjects pilfered the most sweets, far more than the subjects who were poor. And again, when it came to games of chance, it was the rich subjects who bumped up their scores. For the rich feel entitled to cheat, for it's their right to win. So when you hear them insist that, when you hear them boast that money talks, and when you hear them insist that generosity is for idiots, you wonder if it's not time for that pitchforks. But Wat Tyler is a great myth of English folklore, like Robin Hood, though the evidence for his existence is authentic, and he was far more radical and political, wanting to change the system's very essence. William Blake wrote on his engraving that he'd drawn a likeness of Wat Tyler's spectre in the act of striking down the city tax collector who just molested his daughter. And who knows that Wat Tyler won't strike the city again from across the temporal ether. And Wat Tyler was celebrated, his Saxon grit was celebrated in popular song. His renown was spread for saying, "Our life shall not be by the king's permit." By breaking a hedge, ran the song, he knocked a hole in the crown. And although Wat Tyler and John Ball are often portrayed as desperate rebels drenched in gore and in blood, in truth they stood firmly in the people's great radical tradition, the brethren of the free spirit, the family of love. The peasants' revolt went on to inspire mass peasant uprisings right across Europe. By putting the self-serving within its crosshairs, it was giving the downtrodden and excluded some hope. The rebels came close to overthrowing the whole system. Just one dagger's thrust from outright victory. But with money still an illusion and power a constant deception, a sudden revolt might still shake or even overturn the scenery. In the darkness of the evening, the divine bandit John Ball said, the people will dream of the light of the day. A time of freedom, equality, harmony with nature. A time when dragons will no longer stand in their way. The Red Dagger by Heathcote Williams. Revolution down the ages. Acknowledgements first. The heroic attempt in 1381 by the English people to strangle a shit modernity in its cradle. They may have failed, but they ameliorated conditions somewhat. But to explain the genesis of the poem, another acknowledgement had got to go to Rob Newman, the comedian Rob Newman, who gave a talk at Albion Books in Oxford and explained how bewildered and astonished he was that this article still existed, which inspired Heath to write the poem then.
subsequently. But we've got lots of other acknowledgements in the poem, so many voices. First got to say that great revolutionary, Percy Shelley, author of London, extended peace in the poem. William Blake, again, two quotes from William Blake there, his poem London in there. Sigmund Freud, Karl Marx, Frederick Engels, and an anonymous Chartist writing in the Northern Star in 1848, The Red Dagger. Thank you very much for listening.